is to see what the influence of Parker Rhoads' book was on the one side, so that the historical aspect, and I wanted to discuss the problem of its theoretical significance. And so, but I started this work last year, and I had to prepare the paper for Anton. And apart from my personal and family problems that I took at time, I had very short time. But I realized that it would have taken me the 10 years you were talking about before, or even more. But as you shall see, so it's work is just work in progress. And I hope that has some interest. But so, the other day when we were discussing about paradigm shift, you were mentioning it in the discussion about the aims of Anton. I found this quotation on Kuhn, paradigm, notion of paradigm shift, by Margaret Masterman, 1970, and Margaret Master, as you know better than I do, was the founder of the Cambridge Language Research Unit, where Parker Rhoads, Ted Bastin, and others were working. So let us read this quotation. A paradigm must be a construct, because Masterman was objecting to Kuhn not at the notion itself, but the fact that Kuhn was using it in a very sloppy way, and so she was pointing out for a rigorous definition of paradigm. And she says, must be a construct, an artifact, a system, a tool, together with the manual of instruction for using it successfully and the method of interpretation of what it does. And so I shall try to speak about formal semantics. And formal semantics, as I conceive of it, in my opinion, please be ruthless in criticizing my opinion. I am open to that's the purpose for presenting this. Anyway, as I conceive of it, is a fundamental part of such a construction. So in order to achieve this paradigm shift, you need a proper theory of formal semantics. Because in many areas, quantum mechanics, biology, self-organizing system, in sociology, system theory, inspired by Luhmann style, inspired by von Förster and others. So you find emergence of this new idea, but as a whole, there is no consistent overall idea, awareness of this paradigm shift. I'm sorry that I didn't hear the I didn't attend the film, and I will not be trying to find it on internet, because I think one main topic was just that. So that's Parker Rhoads Inferential Semantics, 1978. It was a book he wrote quite late, because somebody was insisting, Yorick Wilkes gave an AMPA a talk on Parker Rhoads. And I shall start from what Yorick Wilkes says in this AMPA paper, 1996, this is his abstract. The paper tries to bring out his view of the role of lattices and graphs in language structure. So, the main purpose, according to Wilkes, and I agree. So just to give a rough idea, that's the quantification lattice. That's another like graph. He uses all this apparatus to develop this theory. So what are, according to Wilkes, that's a habit of this Cambridge group. They were referring to each other via initials. So AFPR was Arthur Frederick Parker Rhodes, and so on. MM was Martin Pasterman, and so they did. So what are his basic ideas? His method originally was to map Halliday's. Halliday was a linguist in Cambridge. The one who developed what, to my knowledge, is called functional linguistics. He was in Cambridge and then went, I think, New Zealand or Australia, and he was active. He came to Bologna some years ago, but a number of years ago. So, and anyway, Parker Rhodes, Halliday was a member of the Cambridge Language Research Unit. And Parker Rhodes, his method was to map Halliday's syntactic constituents for a sentence and their inclusion relations onto some elementary Boolean lattice, and then to attempt to determine the correct parsing of lattice operations. He always attributed his use of lattices for natural language structure to Margaret Masterman. Margaret Masterman, by the way, Yorick Wilkes wrote a paper on Margaret Masterman as well. And he says that she probably got, she was, as you know, Braithwaite's wife, and she had attended Wittgenstein lectures. And he remarks that she didn't attend to her very much because Wittgenstein had problems with women. So that's according to Yorick, to Yorick Wilkes. Anyway, probably she was influenced, and many have recognized it by Wittgenstein's, later Wittgenstein's ideas. So, Parker Rhodes acknowledges that the idea came from Margaret Masterman, but although her original insight was quite different from what he, Parker Rhodes, came to use those structures for. So his basic claim in the book is that there is a weak notion of inference. About these notions we shall, I did want to make an extensive presentation of the contents of the book, which would be a paper by itself. But I shall take into account reviews, and I'll probably come back to some of these points. Anyway, basically, there is a weak notion of inference just when understanding A allows B to be understood. So this relationship between inference and understanding is crucial, as we shall see. So this notion of inference is quite different from the ordinary notion of inference in logic, because it's a relationship between inference and understanding. And his inference lattices are a model of that relationship. And an advantage of using lattices was the fact that the lattice gives the closure of the structure of inference of a language, and the fact that the structure yields decidability. So that's were two important factors to decide for this kind of representation. And then Yorick Wilkes says, Parker Rhodes' book has not been influential. And I would say yes and no. So I began starting to find reviews of the book. I was able to find two proper reviews only, and another thing which I shall show. For instance, Jeffrey Sampson, D.B. Pollard, and Fritz Lehmann. So the first two, quite close to the appearance of the book, are two real reviews, appeared in journals, as you shall see. Fritz Lehmann, but I'll tell you something about him later. So, Sampson wrote his review, Journal of Literary Semantics. Sampson ended his career as emeritus professor at the University of Texas as a professor of informatics. And he is described in an encyclopedia article as an expert, they say, computation and linguistics. So I said computation and linguistics and economics. I add this because this explains the point of view of the reviewer. So what does Sampson say? It's another very difficult book. Where does this oddity come? Butler-Rhodes' complex structure of theorizing is sharply at odds with the best non-contemporary views. So, Butler-Rhodes is completely out of the context of the discussion in this case, in linguistics. He is a linguist. And he goes on, he aims to describe our thoughts as they are before they are clothed in words. And this is an important point, I shall come back again later on this point. A point which calls into question a relation between what linguists call surface structure and deep structure. So, but more about this later. So, thoughts. He wants to describe thought as they are before they are clothed in words. And they are things with a complex, determined structure of their own that is related only quite loosely to the structures of the sentence. So there is no isomorphism between I would say the syntactical form of the sentence and the structure of the thought that which is the sentence content that the sentence wants to convey. And this is an important point which I take for very. The central phenomenon in thinking is inference, as already said. The system of thought must form a calculus, but this calculus will not be very similar to those traditionally defined and discussed by logicians. So it's quite something quite different. And here, an idea of what it is calculus of practical inference. He calls it rematic. And this is another very interesting point. It's not primarily concerned with truth values of statements. Why? Unlike logic, it is very much concerned with their relevance in a given speech context. So, relevance, well, as far as I know about logic, there was Anderson and Belknap who tried to, they wrote this book, Attainment, just to catch with in the connective, in the basic connective of attainments, the notion of reference. But I don't think that this work, this doesn't work, at least, given the paradigm inside which logicians operate, which is, if it's not a truth functional operator, it's described a priori. So that's, anyway, So this Tartulus offers several superficially different but formally equivalent notation for representing grammata, which is the rim is the content of a sentence. The most perspicuous notation treats them as graphs. Practical inference, unlike traditional logic, is highly context sensitive, and party roads need some way of formalizing context too. And here is the critical remarks of Samson towards party roads. The sentence in which party roads presents the components of the theory suggests strongly that he decided on his remota first and thought about the inference rule only after the remota was settled on. So he says, the question underneath is empiricism versus use of abstract structure. That's the basic question from an epistemological point of view. Samson quotes directly Parker Rhodes, who says, mathematical theory provides techniques for determining what system can and cannot be used as calculi or inferential system. And Samson adds, I find it problematic. Already he starts to disagree. Once one begins to question the relevance of mathematical proof, his theory rapidly unravels. This dramatic system could be valuable, surely, only if it were liable to testing against empirical observation. So, and that's a point, and I don't think that even your equips got it completely straight, as I shall say later. The end result, that's his final concluding remark, the end results could have been modified and improved by feedback from the scholarly community. Again, it's not the customary way of the debate in a scholarly community over the years. And this explains why it was so not so influential, so it had no great resonance. He has chosen instead to produce one big make or break statement, and it must be just judged a failure. So let's go on with the other reviewers. Pollard, a senior lecturer in philosophy, University of Glamorgan, now University of South Wales. What are his interests? Aesthetics and the semantic of fiction. So his interest, for instance, from his other publication, Literature and Truth, Fictions and Reality. And then he reviewed this book of Le Pore, and Paul was someone who shared positions by Davidson, who says that a semantic theory must at least yield a determination of truth conditions. But Parker Rhodes didn't care about truth conditions. So that's why Pollard find it odd. And he draws a lot from the previous review of Samson. Practically, he says the same things, but from a point of view of a philosopher dealing with aesthetics and literature. Occasionally, the author addresses himself directly to the relations between natural and formalized language. The former, natural language, there would be a lot to say about the notion of what it is, natural language for him. But anyway, natural language does not operate a system of truth values like that of formal logic. Perhaps so, but one's confidence ebbs when he asserts that there are no false statements in natural language, only rejected ones. And the point is that I think he cares about what is called the conceptual aspect of semantics, so the relationship between concepts and between notions. And then you can say whatever, and the problem of testing the truth or the falsity of the statement is another matter which relies on experience, experiment, but it's not the problem of developing a theory of how this kind of inference, very closely connected to understanding, works in natural language. Natural language is language as people use it in everyday intercourse. That's basically his idea. And obviously this is conditioned by the goal of all this research, because at the Cambridge Language Unit they were working on a program for they called it mechanical translation, machine translation they call it now, and so obviously they wanted practical application of this system to everyday language, the language used normally in communication between persons, and that's I think it's his notion of natural language. And finally, Pollard says, Dr. Parker Rhodes' work is certainly challenging and stimulating, but the effect tends to be blunted by the unfamiliarity, again, is out of the context of his technical epic. Much useful work remains to be done in indicating just how far his results differ from better known systems. So, as I said, he practically says the same as Samson, but from a slightly different point of view. Oh, now we come to this chap here. It took me quite a while to discover who, well, I saw what he was publishing. He was editing conference. He was dealing with the branch of artificial intelligence dealing with conceptual structures and semantic networks. And in the literature, this literature, there's a kind of going back to Parker Rhodes and Margaret Masterman for their use of lattices in the analysis of language. He works for this Psych Corporation, which was an IE corporation, and they were, it was based in Austin, Texas, it's probably still there. The Psych from the Encyclopedia project is an artificial intelligence project that attempts to assemble a comprehensive ontology and knowledge base of everyday common sense knowledge. So this is quite an agreement with the target of Parker Rhodes and of machine translation, with the goal of enabling AI application to perform human-like reasoning. So he has a paper. No, that's not a paper. That's his brief in the communication of the ACN. There is a forum, and in this forum there is a brief part written by Lehmann, which is entitled Neglected Work. But the neglected work is also Parker Rhodes, but basically it's PERS, the existential graphs developed by PERS. The only researcher I know who uses PERS ideas in artificial intelligence, conceptual structures and so on, says he is John Sower of IBM. And he insists on the need to go back to PERS. who provided rigorous rules for manipulating the diagrams which preserve truth and constitute a system of proof. Peirce anticipated many of Harrell's ideas. Harrell was another one working in visual diagrams, proof diagrams, something like that, and others, among which we find Barker Rhodes. Anticipated many of Harrell's and others' ideas as how to compose logical blocks. What are logical blocks? Binary large objects. And all the machinery of Parker Rhodes' analysis was understood by Lehmann as a very large logical block. That's already said. Yes, it's more or less the same. In A.F. Parker Rhodes' Inferential Semantics, an algorithm is presented for manipulating interlocking blocks within his concept lattices. And it goes on. By the 60s, lattice theory was already recognized as important for semantic networks by a couple of the earliest artificial intelligence researchers, Masterman and Parker Rhodes, but they failed to excite many others. So they worked in isolation practically, and the artificial intelligence community was not so much influenced directly, at least immediately, by their work. But as we shall see, there is going back to the ideas. So what was Masterman's and other things like that. Within artificial intelligence, at least, this approach has languished forgotten. One result of the original work of the Cambridge Language Research Unit is the inferential semantics by the late Parker Rhodes, a difficulty enlarging an appreciated book, belatedly published in 1978. It combines mathematical lattice theory with semantic syntactic and even tonal, that comes from Halliday, tonal analysis of sentences. And here is the point. Recent research has rediscovered Parker Rhodes' approach, establishing lattices of consumption relations between what are really labeled relational graphs based on and so on. Here is a description, a particular description of what is this for that, because I was running. And then in another paper, being partial of the set of participating, what's participating? It's the role of somebody who participates in an event, and we wanted to analyze formally these kind of things. And he says, our point of view, we contrast conventional approaches with what? With systems like the SIG program, the one we mentioned before, so was new system, and the systems of Somers and Parker Rhodes. So, recent research revives, rediscovered Parker Rhodes. Then, says Lehmann, we apply the former concept analysis of Wille's school. Who's Wille? Wille is a mathematician at the University of Cologne who formed a group to work on what they called formal concept analysis, which consists basically in creating a lattice representing the inverse relation between extension and intension. And they use this approach. And we have described what a formal concept analysis is. was developed by Bill and his colleagues over the last 15 years based on the fundamental theory about Galois connections. Burmeister, Gunther, and others in the former concept analysis group at the Technische Hochschule Darmstadt developed a program that generated a concept lattice of intentional and extensional concept based on a table showing a dyadic inherence relation between the set of object and the set of attributes. So that's, and these two people, Pris and Ould, they are people working in formal concept analysis. And they say, in the 1950s and 60s, Margaret Masterman, a pioneer research using a thesaurus for machine translation. They formalized her paper describes a lattice-based model of Rogers' thesaurus. Yorick Whip says Parker Root was not so much interested in this use of lattices as Masterman did, as we mentioned before, because he used it to formalize the notion of grammar, the content of sentences, the semantic content of sentences. Since lattice-based models of Rogers' thesaurus have also been described in recent formal concept analysis, the idea now of the paper is to revisit Masterman ideas, to formalize algorithms in formal concept analysis notation, and to compare her ideas to modern research. So later on, this research was, at least in this domain, quite, I would say, quite influential. That was the idea. And, well, I'm trained in historical research. Parker Rogers studied Masterman's ideas, so he programmed a faster program to compute. And back to Yorick Wilkes' assessment of Parker Rogers. So, and this is the point against what Samson was saying, basically that the use of mathematical abstraction didn't square very well with empirical observation. Wilkes says, he strongly rejects any form of empiricism. Sensations, for him, were externalized, while at the same time, he knew meanings by introspection. Sort of quite an inversion of what it's usually and normally thought about. These lattices are a fully abstract structure. So, and then he tries to find some connections with contemporary works. Chomsky, in the first place. Well, he says they have much in common because of the use of formal means to deal with linguistic phenomena. But Chomsky did initially at least believe in structures which he called the deep structure, a notion Parker Rogers could never accept. On this point, I must say that I do not agree totally with this, but let's go on. Because this is Parker Rogers. The way forward seems to me to require that first we get clear about the structure of expressible thought as they exist before and after the speech. Why before? Before, because the speaker has something in mind as he has to express it. And after, why? Because it takes into account what linguists normally don't, the listener. And the listener has to do the inverse operation, starting from what he hears or he reads, and try to get the thought, the content conveyed. And again, Parton Roads. My subject, as I have said, is the structure, relationships and notation of thoughts, a purposely vague word which I shall sharpen in due course, in the pre-linguistic, pre-utterance condition. I want to discuss the meaning of sentences without consideration of the sentence themselves through which they are expressed. If that's not a deep structure, I don't know how to name it. So it's probably not deep structure in Chomsky's sense, but there are two different levels. The sentences actually pronounced and written down, and the thoughts which come first and after. It's the information content conveyed by language, by text. And is there a clue to this antinomy? Is there a deep structure or is there not? I have a surmise, but I'll examine another case first and then I'll come back to this point. Wilkes talks about levels of abstraction. Parton Roads goal in the book, as its title suggests, was not primarily lexical, but a general theory of inference in natural language, and, most ambitiously, the relationship of inference to understanding. Understanding has nothing at all to do with inference as normally understood, but only with the relationship between what Parton Roads calls repertory, the sets of, if I say something, it has a propositional content. All that you can infer, starting from this propositional context, this constitutes what he calls the repertory, the set of all the lemma as inferable from what you say, from the content of what you say, in his special sense of infer, of course. And the rehearsal, which is the set of surface rimas. He calls surface, he uses the term surface to distinguish it. So I think that there is a distinction between a surface structure and a kind of deep structure. Because the speech process, as he understands it, is this. The speaker has a thought in mind. Each lesson is the process to externalize it in sentences, in text. And then there is the listener who does the opposite operation. He tries to internalize in the thought what he gets out of the utterances. And this is how precisely Parton Roads defines rehearsal and repertory. How much time do I have got?
20 minutes.
20 minutes, well, yes. Thus, side by side with the rehearsal of the context, which is a sequence of utterances, surface structures, and the context itself, which is a single, complex rima, the set of all the rimas inferable from the one which is the context of the utterance. We need the term for the complete set of remata generated by an appropriate inference procedure from the context. This set of remata, as I said before, I shall call the repertory of the context. Note here that rehearsal is a term referring to the object language, whereas context and repertory both belong to a different level of abstraction. And this is a crucial point for me. There are different levels of abstraction. Also, the rehearsal is a kind of abstraction because we have a presentation of the lexical and semantic, syntactical structure of the utterance. Whereas content and repertory belong to a different level of abstraction, that of grammatical notation, the lattices and graphs, which can be used as a meta-language for discussing what an object language expresses. So the point is, from my understanding, the relationship between these two levels. And I shall start from another statement by Wilkes. Parker wrote, "Freely used strings of binary numbers." This is a computing question. He didn't use high-level languages, he used binary code. This view has contentful strings. So they were interpreted, according to Parker, binary strings. This view marked them off totally. Well, this is quite a lot to say. From contemporary language work in both linguistics and artificial intelligence. We have seen that artificial intelligence goes back to Parker Rhodes. And a remark on self-reference, and that's another crucial point, very delicate point. His desire to avoid self-representation showed that he could not accept the assumption that language can be its own representation. His book began with warnings against the perils of self-reference. But listen to what Parker Rhodes has to say. It might well be regarded as a point of good style in normal conversation. You cannot sort of make fun using paradoxes or things of this kind in normal conversation. It's not good style, according to Parker. Avoid these instances of possible self-reference. And as a peculiar example of self-reference, he, in the bibliography, quotes his own book. And he says, this can be done even in the most natural language, but it's not usual. Anyway, a possibility even in the most natural language, but it has something pathological. So he warns, but this warning is at the level of the surface structure, in my opinion. It has nothing to do with the other abstract. Yet, Wilkes himself, self-modeling is exactly what he did come to accept in the realm of physics. So he says there's a contradiction between Parker Rhodes' work in on language and Parker Rhodes' works on quantum physics. Because he, in quantum physics, he did not came to accept in the realm of physics where, like Weizsäcker, he was against models as such. For quantum phenomena, since its combinatorial logic itself, became the object of study, as opposed to being modeled by it, as in conventional view of science. So here there is no separation between the model and the higher abstraction and the direct representation of reality as it is in physics. But I think this applies also to language. But again, if that is the case, did not see any kind of metaphysical consistency between the study of language and quantum. They go along different lines. I don't think so. And why should he, as they are plainly not the same? Of course, since I happen to hold the self-description view of language as possible and indeed necessary, I wish Parker Rhodes had held it too. But there it is. So here I add my observation, which is a way to pass to the second, but don't be afraid, won't take me long. So self-reference, in my opinion, does not concern the representation of language as text. That is, as the sensible tokens that are the result of the act of expression and the occasion of the act of comprehension, the surface level. Self-reference concerns the representation of the relation between the surface level language and its theory, the abstract structures that describe the whole speech process, or the lattice form of representation. And the possible clue, Wilkes himself, computational about computational representation. Parker Rhodes freely used strings of binary numbers as contentful strings. He actually wanted arbitrary representation, whereas other people, they say they are purely conventional and they don't describe, it's just computer code, they don't describe anything real as proper representation. But Parker Rhodes was insisting that they were proper representation, even in the form of binary strings, as we've seen. He believed representations accessible as such and interpretable, not wholly conventional. So, my conclusion, if both object language and meta-language are conceived as proper and direct representation, the meta-language is not a representation of the object language and then the object language represents reality. They both impinge on reality itself, in my opinion. And this is a clue to the direct representation, albeit of more or less idealized situation, as Parker Rhodes himself says. It is possible to think that also in language, as a quantum phenomena, he was against models as such, and it is possible to admit of self-modeling in language representation as it is in physics. But be as it may, that's something we can try to do.
10 minutes.
Pardon?
10 minutes.
10 minutes, thank you. And then I'll go to, as Nicky was saying, towards theory. It's just a very, there is no ground. When I deal with historical subjects, I can do probably something better from a scholarly point of view, but here, I have submit this to your criticism, and the more radical it is, more it will please me. So, what's this new approach? Last year, doing the paper on Parker Rhodes, I had this idea, starting from a survey of classical solution, classical meaning traditional, actual solutions in logic and mathematics to find possible clues to solutions for self-reference. How do they deal in different areas with this problem? Now, I think you have to sort of do the inverse operation, and as we shall see, it's something like we were talking to Nick before, Weir. Did he had an idea with the Cartesian closed categories, and see, with this I can explain things, but we shall see in a moment. So start from an hypothesis, test it, and revise classical solutions. In my understanding, light physics, formal semantics, has not only an abstract, so to say, static form, but also a substance, as Jeffrey was saying. And here I draw very much on so those of you who didn't attend the first part of the conference, but because I'm doing referring back to things already said. So I think that formal semantic light physics as a substance which is a dynamics of lexical items. They are not just formal structures. how do they combine, how you manipulate, how do they combine to create meaning, context and so on. That's not pure form. For instance, given and this is given a set of terms, adding or removing one term, reconfigures the entire network of mutual relation between the lexical items. If you start from the notion of Wittgenstein or language game, so the relationship between the terms we use, if you change the set, you change everything. And this was done, that is a group working with Google. They find out a vector representation of words, and then they were scanning big data analysis, Wikipedia articles to find profiles of important people. And they found that if they were removing the terms referring to computing in Bill Gates' profile, it would look like that of Bill Clinton and Putin. So if you just add or remove a term, it makes quite a difference. So that's something that I have in mind. So, self-reference. And this is from 5 minutes. Yes, I'll go very quick. Includes the subject. For instance, when Lou spoke about Wittgenstein's rule, Tractatus wanted to keep it out, and Spencer Brown, whose mark is self-referring. Self-reference cannot be dealt with through the absolute and dualistic opposition object language versus meta language. I'll come back to this. Object, observed, and representation, subject or observer, belong to the same system, something which was insisted upon in the last part of the film that we didn't have the chance of seeing in its totality. What happens then the problem when the object, for instance, language is itself a representation of a sign for that matter? In this case, I think semiotic matters. An hypothesis. Peter was saying there are these two spaces, physics and maths. Jeffrey was talking about pure structure and substance. Peter was insisting on the combination of the two of space. And this combination is a nilpotent duality. So I think this is the real clue to go towards a proper solution. Because a nilpotency constraint entails self-reference. I'll tell you something about Neoplatonism. When I started reading Neoplatonism, I thought that theory of types was a good thing. But there was an inconsistency because theory of types can go on. It's true that higher order logic can be reduced to second order logic, and this is important. So, in fact, there are only two levels, and the Neoplatonists have only three levels, and the third level is unknown, the void, the space without distinction, as in Spencer Brown. So, an impotency, and it's an impotency, this impotency constraint entails self-reference. We were talking briefly before about Aristotle, Plotinus took over Aristotle's notion of the nous, which is the object and the act of thinking, same thing. And, but the difference was that for Aristotle that was the top level. For Neoplatonists there was another level which was an impotency because the unknown, which was the one of which you cannot say anything. Subject and object, then observer and observed, they must belong to the same. So you have to have a system encompassing both subject and object. So my third, I'll go very quickly on this couple of slides yet. Problematic areas where this problem comes out, paradox, secularity, reverse, predicative and predicate definition, definition of truth, attempted solution, the distinction, as I said, between object language, meta language, semantic assent, characterized by Quine, how I wrote the logic, deduction theory, all the work on the justification of deduction. But cases worth considering. For instance, in the psychology of perception, an American psychologist about 40 or 50 years ago, he was analyzing multi-stability in perception. So these things that you can see in one way, like the duck, the famous duck rabbit in Wittgenstein. And there is another guy, a German professor, Hagen, who developed what he called synergetics, studying unstable states, critical unstable states in physics. Because, for instance, the point where liquid state goes to gas or ice. And there was somebody, I went to talk to him in Milan, he was a physicist working. He wrote a book comparing the symmetry effects of the formation of crystals with some of artistic production like Escher and Plane on this double multi-stability in perception in symmetry configurations. So there are two symmetries that play together in the same surface structure, I would call it. Oh, no. So, in logic and maths, there are some attempts to come out of the Tarski's world. Barbeis and Leccemendi wrote a book to teach logic with computers. And then they discovered that the students were using diagrams, and they said, but this is another way of proving, like the example the other day with your brain, that I said, if you turn around, then you use a diagram instead of using a formal derivation in algebraic derivation. Loewe, the paper we were talking about, and Spencer Brown Marx. Loewe, it's here, he uses Cartesian closed categories to deal with all these phenomena, referential paradoxes, incompleteness theory, and fixed point theories. And the example he uses, Loewe uses Cantor's theorem, Russell's paradox, the non-definability of satisfiability, Tarski's non-definability of truth. So the problem areas I was thinking about, Gödel, first incompleteness theory. And then I end up with partial, and I insist on partial. When we were talking the other day, Demarque refers both to...
But not in the first place.
Yes, but...
not in the first place, where there's only distinction.
I'm not criticizing.
You're not hearing me. Partial identity is an extra distinction. In the first place, there are none.
In the first place, because the Demarque, in my understanding, it's an operator on the void, not an operator on a value.
No, you're still way up in lots of distinctions. You have to imagine letting go of many distinctions.
Once you create one distinction, then
you're insisting on a distinction. It's fine, right? It's fine. Insist on as many distinctions as you want.
Anyway, it's a matter of discussion. Thank you. I exhausted my time. Sorry.
Let's thank Dino. In the interest of time, we'll have the discussion during the tea break, unless we want to have Lou have to comment.
Well, I have a sort of general question. Why among many linguists is self-reference regarded as something that should be avoided in their systems, when in language itself, it's full of self-reference?
No, that's the logician, basically, and many linguists using fallen means to take over the conventional approach by the logicians. I came up very interested in logic, but it happened to me something more or less like happened to Wittgenstein. I was against all from Husserl to Wittgenstein to Frege. They were anti-psychologistic. And I said, yes, I agree with that. But that was in...
We're talking about people who are working with language.
Yes.
And in language, in ordinary language, it's full of self-reference. Sentences can refer to themselves.
Yes.
I can refer to myself, you can refer to yourself.
In another talk, I quoted...
A word can describe itself.
Yes.
So that self-reference is intimately related with language.
I agree.
And so it's kind of strange that linguists don't take that on from the beginning as something they need to model.
To say briefly, probably I'm not able to express my idea to convey my rhema very well through what I'm going to say, but self-reference is inherent in the use of language, and you cannot take it off. And for instance, an Italian linguist, he calls it, he has a technical expression to the all natural language have this property of self-reference to itself. And that is, if you read a linguist quoted Tarski, that he has a note, Tarski, in which he wants to take this property of language away from the definition.
We understand when we make certain kinds of mathematical systems that we have chosen, yes. There won't be self-reference in this.
So
why don't you guys continue?
Just one sentence to conclude. So I'm firmly convinced, and that's the purpose of everything, that self-reference is inherent in language.
Yeah.
But once you have made a distinction, you have two things.
Well,
yes, provisionally. It's provisional.
I'm just saying, if you're modeling language, then it doesn't make a lot of sense to avoid self-reference. If you're modeling mathematical structure, then you can say, okay, I'll make a structure that doesn't have self-reference. I'll make my sets so that they can't be members of themselves. I'll do this.
Yes.
And we do this.
But this distinction,
find out,
and that's
that it
my
points us at another level, but that's all.
It's only provisional. That's what I meant by saying partial identity.
Yeah.
So they are both identical and, at the moment of the distinction, partially distinct. And these two levels, from an epistemological point of view, the reflection is very well developed.
How do you do that? How do you set the alarm off?
Beautiful.
What is it?
Catch it.
Those who want to stay, listen to the discussion, stay.
No, I just want to talk to you.
Come back in about 20, 25 minutes. Roger, is this one of your aliens?
Must be.
It is the way how to stop the talk.
Yeah. It's got a little page of radio.
I've got the kind of...
Whose toy is it?
It's got camera in it. The camera's not operating.
I don't know. We don't see the person.
How much did they cost?
Who's this?
Still try to get
there. There's a camera too,
Randall? They're coming in it.
Wow.
Oh, I hope I'm blurry now. It's all blurry.
Yeah, never mind. Look, this doesn't matter. This is a
door. They're on their way at 6 o'clock.
Yes.
They're going to be here for 8, isn't it?
Yeah, okay. But what I mean, do we have to pay them a petrol money? Or?
I think there's petrol money. I think it's just petrol money.
Yeah. Can we get some flowers for them?
Oh, what, now?
Yeah. Oh, or between.
Okay.
Can
you? Yeah, sorry, sir. I don't.
You know, as a thank you, you know, and then how much would petrol money be?
Yeah.
How much?
Should be that.